that is being used in widespread application. Again, this is a technique that might be usable in some research applications. There has been a variety of efforts that have gone on and are still going on that look at various approaches for automating carbonyl sampling and analysis. And the big issue with automating the technique is collecting the carbonyl compounds. One needs to be able to do that with high efficiency, and so a lot of the attempts have used a diffusion scrubber. An example is shown here where one has a inner tube with a DMPH solution flowing through it, and an outer annular region that has air sampling with carbonyl compounds flowing through it, and the carbonyl compounds can be acting as a derivatizing agent and be pulled into the solution. There are a couple of different types of tubing that have been used. There's a porous Teflon tubing that's been used. Navion tubing has also been used for this approach. Diffusion scrubbers will collect carbonyl compounds. So the approach works up to a point. Collection efficiency is always a bit of a question with this kind of technique. This shows an automated system that has been used. This system has been applied in a very limited scale, but it is collecting carbonyl compounds in this diffusion inhibitor, forming the derivative, and then in a continuous automated system, it can inject it into an HPLC, do the analysis while it is collecting the next sample. So this is an approach that has been used on a very limited scale. It hasn't been developed a lot yet. This is continuous data from that work for formaldehyde and acetaldehyde concentrations. This data was done over 10 years ago, or collected over 10 years ago. This is one approach. There have been two or three others. We'll look at a couple of other examples of this as we go on. But none of them have really taken off. So this gives you much better time resolution, and you're analyzing the sample as you're collecting. So it's not collect, take back to the lab, analyze, or the operation. This shows a comparison between the continuous measurement data and cartridge data. The range of values represented by this error bar are the range of hours of measurement for the sampling period for the DMPH cartridge. These were 24-hour samples, and they were hourly continuous measurements. So the mean agrees fairly well for both formaldehyde and acetaldehyde. So there is certainly the approach seems to work reasonably well. Collection efficiency is something that in this particular work hasn't been explored quite as well as it needs to be. There are a variety of different groups that have worked on various scrubbing techniques. This is instead of using an annular inhibitor, this is using a parallel plate diffusion scrubber to way of doing the collection. The same idea, flowing the rivetizing agent through one part of the system before air sample to the other part of the system. The air passes through, or the carbonyl is passed through an membrane reacting to the pH, and you can analyze it by which you will see. So this allows one to automate the systems. This is looking at collection efficiency with this parallel plane here. The triangle or the diamonds show you the actual nature of collection efficiency. The star or the asterisk shows what you calculate based on theory. You see the theory and experiment agree better at very low flow rates. So these don't look very well at high flow rates. So if you get below a half a liter, then you may have decent collection efficiency. So one really needs to explore the collection efficiency settings for low flow rates. So there's more research to be done with this technique. This is hourly data for this system for a variety of carbonyl compounds. Has hourly measurements. The white parts of the bar are daytime, the shaded parts of the bar are nighttime measurements, and the sort of hourly measurements for evaluating this salt. So you can see the variability exists in the concentrations of the whole range of carbonyl compounds. That's really possible in the analyze for this approach. This is another automated HPLC system. This one is different in the fact that it is not using a diffusion scrubber kind of an approach to remove carbonyls. It's using a DMPH cartridge approach. So it's has the advantage that a cartridge has of having high collection efficiency, but it gets around some of the problems that one has with equity of stuff being collected on the cartridge and sitting there for a while before you analyze this, forming other compounds, the dimers and triers of those unsaturated carbonyl compounds. This system has been used in a limited range of studies thus far. The big difference is the cartridge is a steel tube that's packed in silica, and the system coats it with DMPH, dries it, then collects the sample, then extracts the sample and analyzes it all in an automated cycle. So one can, reusing the same cartridge, this cartridge has been reused for several weeks between changes without any significant problems. The system seems to work reasonably well. It is using a micro kind of HPLC approach, so it's much smaller column, much lower flow rates, and the lower detection limits that come with micro and nano dose HPLC kinds of techniques. So it's the collection efficiencies for carbonyl compounds are shown over here, so they're quite high, a little over 100% on average, which is hard to do. with an ozone trap there, the amount of carbonyl that needs to be in the ozone trap has been investigated as well. The blank levels, because you're continuously coating and analyzing the cartridge, blank levels are quite low. Detection limits are quite low. Sensitivity for C1, C2, and C3 compounds are in the range of 12 to 20 parts per trillion. 0.012 to 0.02 parts per billion. So it's a very sensitive technique. The sample flow rates, the sample volumes are fairly low as well. This shows the solid line up here at the top. There's ozone, the rest of the samples reflect different carbonyl compounds. The triangles here are formaldehyde. Formaldehyde is shown on this scale over here. So we're looking at 10^1 part per million levels. This is measured in all of this data is from a rural area of Canada, north of Toronto, so there's nothing for us. Concentrations of carbonyl compounds are pretty low. Formaldehyde and acetaldehyde are both, most of the time, below a part per million concentration. You can see considerable variability and a lot of sensitivity. Also here is acetone. Up here, and it's again about 1 part per billion. The circles are YXL, dicarbonyl compound, and it is in that 0.1 to 1 part per billion range. YXL, the reason it is as high as it is because it can be made by oxidation of biogenic. So most of the carbonyls are probably biogenic origin. The sensitivity of this approach, the time resolution of this approach looks like it might be reasonable, but it